Good afternoon. Can everybody hear me? So now I know you are awake after lunch, because that is the most important thing. So it's a great honour. You heard earlier on, I've given talks in many countries about the Library of Birmingham, but this is the first time I have been invited to Thailand. It's my first time in the country. Everybody has been very kind, very generous. I'm very happy to be here. It's a great honour to be talking with you and sharing our experiences with you. So for 18 short months, the Library of Birmingham was, I think, the most talked about public library in the world. We attracted millions of new visitors for many, many different purposes to come to the library. We won countless awards. We developed a new model for service delivery in the public library. And we were looking for new ways to engage with the public, engage with our community, and embed the public library in the community that it serves. And if I have one theme this afternoon, that's the one I'm going to choose. So the Library of Birmingham is a very large library. It's 35,000 square meters. It's the largest public library in Europe. But I hope that, and of course there are larger libraries in other parts of the world, but I hope that you will take some lessons, you'll find some lessons in what I have to say to you that apply to any library, because the lessons, in a way, are ones that Kimberly was talking about this morning. They're about innovation, about risk-taking, about inspiration. Don't be afraid. We are more powerful as librarians than we'd like to think we are. We do have power. We should take risks. We should innovate. I found inspiration from all over the world. I'll say a bit more about that in a moment, for the process and the model for developing the Library of Birmingham. And I think you should find inspiration everywhere you go. So when we gave our brief to our architect for the Library of Birmingham, which was in about 2008, and the library opened in 2013, there were three key themes which we asked the architect to bear in mind that were absolutely critical importance to the library. The first was that the library should be welcoming and inclusive to everybody in the community, that it should present no barriers in its design. The second was that we wanted the library to be part of the public realm. The idea that the public library is a public space, it doesn't belong to me as the director, or the politicians, or to the staff. It belongs to you, the members of the public, the community who use it. So how do we capture that idea in the design of public spaces? And then thirdly, we wanted to invite our visitors to the library to step into a journey of exploration, of discovery, and above all, of learning. If I'm passionate about one thing, it's not books, it's not reading, it's learning. It's about finding new ideas and people learning from new ideas, whether they're in books, whether they're from other people or from other media, but actually ideas that help them to grow as individuals. That's what the library should be about. And that can be quite dangerous, because ideas can be quite radical, can be revolutionary. It works. This idea that the library, and that's, yeah, does the laser work on this? Yeah. So our new library in Birmingham is here, and you can see some of the outdoor spaces that engaged the library with the city. And I will say that Birmingham has a very different climate to Bangkok. So it's a little bit more possible to spend lots of time outdoors. But we designed garden terraces for the public on these levels, and an open-air amphitheatre for dramatic and musical and poetry performance. And two things that Kimberly mentioned earlier on that I will say. Here we have ping pong tables, and here you can buy, actually I'm not sure if you can buy beer, but you can buy wine. So we wanted to try and make the library as inclusive as possible. I'm often asked where we drew inspiration from in our visits around the world. And we spent a lot of time. We went to Africa, to the new library at Alexandria, to North America, to new libraries at Seattle and Vancouver. A lot of new libraries in Europe as well. And everywhere you go, every library you go in, whether it's large or small, should provide you with just something that makes you think, yeah, we could do that. That's a good idea. But I wanted to touch briefly about two libraries that actually you will never get to visit, but they provided a lot of inspiration for me in my thinking. And the first is this. It's Alberto Manguel, the library at night. He's a Spanish man who now lives in France. This is his private library, and you can just see him hiding in a dark corner. And the theme of the library at night is this. That during the daytime, the library is a place of order, and we have Dewey classification systems. We have catalogues. We have people to answer your inquiries and take you to the things that you want. The library at night, it becomes a darker place, and surprising things happen. The books call to each other, and ideas emerge which collide, and you find things that you were not expecting to find. You're learning from discovery and surprises. And that's the theme of Alberto Manguel's library, which is not organized in any way that you would recognize, but he's interested in how ideas collide and just make you think. And if I do nothing else today, that's what I would like you to do. The second private library that gave me inspiration is this. La Biblioteca del Bosque, which means the Library of the Forest. And this is a Spanish man, Miguel Ángel Blanco. This library has taken 25 years to create so far, and that's it. It's 1,000 volumes. None of them is a book. None of them is a book. What they are is he's a man who likes to walk. He walks in the mountains, he walks in the woods, he walks by the seashore. And he collects things as he goes. They may be leaves, pieces of bark, a snakeskin, a piece of quartz crystal. And he then collates them into volumes to provide a record of that journey of discovery. And the lesson I took from that is that, yes, these are books, because this is about ideas, and it's about discovery, and it's about taking you on a journey. Find imagination, find inspiration wherever you go. So here's a library that you probably could go, and which again provided us with some inspiration. This is the Library of the Technical University of Berlin in Germany, designed by Lord Norman Foster, British architect. And it's been called the Berlin Brain for perhaps fairly obvious reasons because of its shape. And I've been to many libraries, but this one made me think it's beautiful, it's nicely designed inside and out. But it was this idea of the brain that made me think. And the first thing that I thought about was, you're familiar with the teachings and the thinkings of the great Ranganathan as the architect of library science. His fifth law of library science, which I studied when I was at library school maybe 40 years ago, and I haven't thought about it since. But actually, his fifth law is that the library is a growing organism. So like the brain of a person, it grows through ideas, through learning. And that idea that we want, I don't think that was in Lord Foster's mind when he designed the university library, but it was certainly in our minds that we wanted the library to be a growing organism, one that changed as people used it. What Ranganathan was actually talking about was that the design of a library should allow space for growth, whether that's of staff or organizational growth or room for more books. And nowadays those sound like rather old-fashioned ideas. But he also talked about, although he wasn't a revolutionary by any means, but he also talked about change in society and using the power of education to encourage people to think and to challenge the established order in society. And very much that was something else that resonated with us, that we wanted people to make people think, to challenge established ideas, and to grow themselves as your brain grows, as you receive and process new ideas. I'm actually getting a little bit ahead of myself at the moment, I think, because what I should do is tell you a little bit about the city of Birmingham, because if I go back to my first principle, the library is nothing without the community which it serves. And without understanding the needs of the city, the characteristics of the city and the community, then I don't think it's possible to design a library service, whether that's a building or a service that already exists, without having that knowledge and understanding. So a little bit about Birmingham. It's because I'm going to guess now. Let's do another hands up exercise. How many people have been to Birmingham? One, two, three. So maybe four or five, and that's it. That's good. How many people have been to the UK? Yeah, a few more. Maybe 15, I think, something like that. So not so many. Okay. Well, then you should come. Come and see the library. So a little bit about the history of Birmingham, which is relevant. Birmingham is in the middle of England. It has no coastline, obviously. It has no rivers of any significance. There is nothing in the ground of any value. There is no minerals, no coal, no minerals to extract. It really has no reason to exist. There's no reason why there is a city there, except that it's in the middle. And two things have happened. One, that Birmingham has invented itself as the hub of the transport network in the UK. So in the age of canal building, it was the centre of the canal network. In the age of railway building, it was the centre of the railway network. And now, I'm not sure if we're in the age of the road now, and the motor car, perhaps we are, but it's the centre of England's motorway network. So a bit like outside here, it's one big traffic jam a lot of the time. But what's kept Birmingham going and makes it the second largest city in the UK is the creativity of its population. The Industrial Revolution and many of the inventions that were developed and then marketed around the world from there all started in the Soho Manufactory here, which is Matthew Boulton's workplace, his workshop of the world. And the library has many of the drawings of the engines that drove the Industrial Revolution through the discovery and the harnessing of steam power. And it's still true today that of all the patents for new inventions that are registered in the UK, 65% are made within about a 5-mile radius of Birmingham. So it is the centre of thought. And that was another idea that we wanted to capture in the library. How do we stimulate creativity? And it acquired this name, the City of 1,000 Trades, because if you wanted something made, you went to Birmingham. That's what Birmingham does. It's what it did. Of course, it's changed much since then. So a million people, but it's actually the capital of a regional network, a regional metropolis, if you like, of about 5 million people. Now, none of those numbers may sound very huge in Southeast Asian terms, but 5 million people is about the population of a small European country like Norway or Denmark, for example. So it's a significant area that we're serving. Birmingham has two principal characteristics of its population. It's very young. It's the youngest major city in Europe. So it has a higher percentage of young people under the age of 25 than any other city in Europe. And secondly, it's diversity. Other than Amsterdam, it has more ethnicities represented in the city's population, more languages spoken than any other major European city. And those are both important challenges for a library service, but they're also really important opportunities. If we don't deliver a service that is relevant to young people and that is relevant to minority ethnic communities, then the library service is finished. There we go. So, along with being a major city and with those demographic contexts, comes a lot of challenges. What you can see here are the pictures, just to explain them. This is a retail shopping centre, not nearly as big as a couple I've been in the last 2 days in Bangkok, but it was a radical architectural design for the city to make people talk. And for 10 years before the Library of Birmingham opened, this was the image of Birmingham on all its marketing literature. One of our ambitions was to say, we don't want this city to be about shopping. We want the city to be about learning. So our ambition was to build something, a library, that would then become the image of the city. And we succeeded. This is the lower picture here is the town hall. But along with population characteristics that I mentioned, come a whole series of quite significant challenges. Birmingham has, because it has a youthful population, quite a significant amount, level of unemployment, worklessness above the national average. It has young people without the skills. There are jobs, but the young people don't have the skills to secure them. It has quite high levels of functional illiteracy, so people who cannot meaningfully operate their day-to-day lives in the English language. Some of that is because English is not their first language, but some of it is because the education system has failed them. It has some poor health outcomes, so challenges, whether it's of obesity or teenage pregnancy or people having shorter life expectation than they should have, but difficult healthy outcomes. And all of those things, we thought, the library can change those things. And the key to that is this notion of social capital and community engagement, that the library is capable of delivering better literacy, better standards of literacy, better health outcomes, jobs for people. We can get people who are economically inactive, and we can get them either running their own business or get them into work. And we should set ourselves those goals. Does everybody know who this guy is here? Yes? I've forgotten his name. Prince William, the Duke of Cambridge. So he's second in line to the British throne. And this is a picture of him with school children in the library. And he became quite a champion of the library, very much to our benefit. I talk a little bit about the library site, which was built on what was a car park. The main, you can walk for about 2 miles. Birmingham is not a very big city, about 2 miles from side to side of the city centre, along following this route here. So the library was built on exactly the main pedestrian route through the city. A site with some serious challenges, because it's not big enough for the library we wanted to build, and some quite serious difficulties of access for people without full mobility. But the benefits of that site for us outweighed those disadvantages, because it gave us real engagement with the city. This public square here, with the big wheel in it, that's not there now. This has been completely redesigned, and new metro system is going through here. This is the city's biggest public square, and this is the avenue by which most people walk through the city on their way to work or cultural activities. So that opportunity for us to engage with the community who use the city was one we just couldn't miss. So that was the site that we chose. You've seen a little bit about the shape of the library. If I say a little bit about design, and of course the first thing that you think when you're given the opportunity to design a new library from scratch is that you are going to get everything right. And it's not going to happen. It can't be done. For a start, everything wants to be on the ground floor, and it's not practical. So we tried to conceive that we actually didn't want necessarily to have all the functions of the library in an area around the entrance, because what we wanted to do was to encourage people, and particularly children, to explore the library and to follow that journey of discovery, to want to know what was around the next corner. So I'm often told that the wayfinding around the library and the navigation is not as intuitive as it could be, and that's exactly right. It was deliberate because we wanted people to explore and we wanted children to come up the escalators. This is a travelator rather than an escalator, and there is a glass lift here that they can use. They can go as high as this and they can go in this room here. So people can relate to the city, they can engage with the library, they can go on their own personal voyage of discovery. And other elements that are important from this is we tried to realise that the library is going to be a noisy place. Lots of events, lots of things happening, but there will be some people who want peace and quiet. So the principle that was adopted was that the lower down in the library you are, the noisier it is. So music, children's library. And then by the time you get up to here, this is not very clear what this is, but this is archives and heritage, so very much people wanting to study, do research. So this is a quiet area. So the lower down, the noisier it got. Actually, what we found, and I'll show you some pictures later on, is that it was noisy all the way through, because when you have so many visitors, it's quite hard to control. But we defended that. The quote that's on the screen now is actually from the American author Mark Twain, and so that wasn't spoken by Malala, but Mark Twain, and the message I take from that, and it's one of those principles that actually, the more I look at that quote, I think that's how I want to live my life. So don't ever look back and say, I wish I'd done that. You should always do things. Don't just take the chance and do them. The things you will regret are the things that you didn't do, mostly. And we secured a great publicity coup by getting Malala Yousafzai, now the Nobel Peace Prize winner, of course, to open the library. And I will just read you the quote that she spoke at during her opening speech, because it was inspirational and became much quoted after that. So what did she say? She said, "A city without a library is like a graveyard. And let us not forget that even one book, one pen, one child, and one teacher can change the world. Pens and books are the weapons that defeat terrorism." She's an incredibly brave young lady, and we saw her many times in the library. She made Birmingham after she was shot in October 2012. She made Birmingham her home, her and her family. And she and her father in particular became very good friends to the library. But she, absolute inspirational. And of course, represented for us as well youthfulness and the ethnic diversity of the city of Birmingham. So it stood for some really important principles. And interestingly, after she had opened the library, there was a little bit of noise on Twitter from people saying, why are you getting a Pakistani girl to open a library in Birmingham? And that was great for us, because the noise that came through Twitter to shout down those people who were criticizing that decision and being critical of her was tremendous. So we didn't have to say anything. Social media does it for you. One of the things I wanted to say, and I may have touched on it earlier on, was we are powerful people, librarians, and there's a quote that I've got somewhere from Daniel Burnham, who was the architect and the planner of the city of Chicago in the US, and he said, "Make no little plans. They have no magic to stir men's blood, and probably themselves will not be realized. Make big plans. Aim high in hope and work." And that was what we tried to do. This is a picture of our garden terrace where the public can go. I think this might be before the library opened. But we said, we are going to try and build the best public library in the world. Now, it's not for me to judge whether we did or not. That's somebody else's judgment. But I think you should all be saying that to yourselves in your own communities, whether you're building a new library or just thinking about how might it be tomorrow. For your community, you should be saying, they deserve the best. They actually deserve to be the best public library in the world. Look, people drinking wine, just to prove my point, yes. This just to explore a little bit further, this idea of the public library as public realm, and I will say more about that in a moment. But it was so important to us that we used public spaces and let the public, to an extent, determine how they were used. So this, I think, is a private event. So a corporate company, hired the terrace space, and we serve wine and canapes there. The gardens are important. We have meeting rooms, we have theatre, we have a foyer, all of those spaces where people can mingle. So whether that's in a private gathering or just in the course of library-run events, more about that in a moment, but to encourage the notion that the library is something that belongs to the whole community. There are really no barriers to entrance. This is a picture of the library on the city square and the cafe outside, and really all I'm trying to show here is the extent to which we tried very hard to engage the inside and the outside of the library to make them work together and create a new, I've called it a new brand for the city, a marketing brand, the Library of Birmingham. Big questions that we tried to tackle with library staff and with members of the public in the lead up to the design of the library, were to try and tackle some of the questions about what is a library in the 21st century? What is a librarian? What should they be doing? What's a book? Because it's not that obvious any longer. And this is not a coherent answer, but we came up with the decision that we would continue to call it a library. We could have called it many other things, a knowledge hub, a centre for discovery, an empowerment centre. Almost whenever I take somebody around the library, their response is, this isn't a library, it's something else. And I say, no, this is a library for the 21st century. This is what the library now is. It's a centre for community, community of all sorts, to get together and to learn from ideas, from their own ideas, from other people's ideas, from staff knowledge, from the collections that we have. But it's also a visitor attraction. So it's not one thing, it's many things. It's a social meeting space, it's a business meeting space. People come from different ends of the country to meet in Birmingham because it's in the middle. And what they've started to do is to say, I'll meet you in the library. And that's a result for us, a very positive one. Just a few words rather than a picture on a slide. We talked a lot about, we want to develop a completely new model for the way in which libraries operate. And that involved us on a series of journeys that we were trying to take the service operating model and the library staff, and indeed the sort of understanding that members of the public have. I thought it very interesting to think about, again, something Kimberly said this morning about the issues of listening to the public and not forgetting that you are also the expert. That's more or less what you said, isn't it? Close. And I think that is important. We have to show leadership as a profession, but we also have to listen and engage with the ideas that the public had. More of that coming up. But these were the four journeys that we were taking away from a service which focused on transaction, by which I mean issuing books to people, giving people information in response to inquiries, towards transformation, in which we were encouraging staff to ask the question, what can I do to change your life, to make it better? How can I help you improve? Moving away from service delivery towards service engagement, so actually getting closer to what people actually need rather than what they say they want. Radically moving away from information towards learning. There's such a concept called information overload, which I'm sure you're familiar with, which Google, you'll, even if you don't know the term, you'll know the feeling, that when you Google something, you get millions of responses. And one of the things that I think, if I'd say that one of the radical changes that we made to the staffing complement of the library was that in the old central library, I had 40 information specialists. In the new one, we had 8. And I think that was too many. Where we were focusing people's attention was retraining library staff as business advisors, as learning advisors, helping them to change people's lives. And down the bottom again, I think is an important concept, moving away from resource recovery to resource discovery. And this was quite well investigated by a Danish researcher in about the year 2008, so around about the same time we were developing ideas for the Library of Birmingham. And what he meant was resource recovery is about helping you as a member of the public to find in the library what you know you want. You know it's there, you just don't know where it is, so we'll find it for you. Actually, that's not very interesting. It should be straightforward. It should be self-service. What we should be about is helping people to discover the resources that they didn't know we'd got and creating surprises for them to learn from. And how then do we design better spaces to enable that resource discovery to take place? I've forgotten what I was going to say about this slide. I think it's about community engagement, and the we spend a great deal of time early on in the process engaging with all the key stakeholders in the city about what their ideas of what a library should be in the 21st century. We were very careful not to ask them, did they like the design? We're very careful to try and steer them away from more traditional topics. And an awful lot of what they talked about, as we were trying to raise awareness of the library and engage the public in conversations, so it's not a consultation exercise driven by surveys, but we attended every festival, every event that we could possibly think of to get into conversation with members of the public from age 2 or 3 upwards, nobody too young, nobody too old. How are they going to use the new library? And how would we make sure it was relevant to what they wanted? The picture there is the inside of the great round reading room. It's an exciting space to be in. And what people told us was not that the key topics that came out of that engagement exercise, there were not questions about how many books are there going to be, how the books are going to be arranged, how will the staff function. They wanted to know about the big things, first of all, in the city. How's it being paid for? How am I going to get there? But also they wanted to know about the sustainability of the building. They wanted to know about accessibility. And this is not just people who were themselves disabled in some way, but a lot of conversation coming from the community. It needs to be accessible to everybody. So not just people in wheelchairs, but people who are single mothers maybe, who are trying to work at the same time as bring a family up. They wanted to know about how we were going to separate out noise and quiet. They wanted to know about what the benefits of the library are going to be to the city. So we worked hard to articulate those and to create answers to the questions that were being raised with us. What you have here is a picture of the two fairly small floors of adult lending and the children's story steps. When we went around TK Park yesterday, I saw parts of that which sort of reminded me a little bit of the climbing that we're asking children to do here and the way they could just lie around in different environments. We took great care to listen to people who were saying, well, I don't want a library that looks the same all the way through. You should be designing a library that makes me feel comfortable, whatever I like to sit on, whatever I like, however I like to study. There's a couple of things from this side. One of the most successful ideas that we came up with was the notion of library community ambassadors. So we appointed, I think it was in the end, about 26 people from around the city to act as ambassadors on part of the library. We didn't pay them, they were all volunteers. They came from all walks of life. Some of them were small children who would tell people in school about it. This chap here, the Sikh gentleman, is a radio broadcaster, so he was very helpful to us. Chap here is quite severely disabled, but they ran he and his carer ran a lot of workshops in the library. They have a little business about which is about playmaking with junk materials, and that engaged a lot of children. The general idea was that these were people who had their own communities, and they were communities who actually were not necessarily going to listen very readily to the director of the library service in a suit. It's always grey, I'm sorry. This guy is my favourite ambassador, and my favourite story about the library, really. He's a guy called Ian. And when I first met him, maybe 10 years ago, he was homeless, so living rough on the streets, which is not comfortable even in Birmingham. It's not very warm, for sure. And he used to use the old library because he wanted to keep warm. And he came in and read the newspaper. We made a contract with the company who built the new library that they had to employ apprentices, and they had to take people off the unemployed register, and they had to employ homeless people, offer them a job. If they didn't work, that was okay. But Ian actually did, they offered 26 homeless people jobs, and 20 of them held the jobs down and kept it going. Ian became, he became a supervisor, so he's now got a skill, he's got his own apartment in the city, and he's also a published poet. He's a success story, and he told an awful lot of people about what the library can do for him. So I come back to the place I started. It's about engaging with your community and finding new ways to do it, because, as I said, I, as director, I can't engage with the whole of the community. These people can. I think I've said much of this already, that we got a good number of young people with skills, and getting people on the lot with long-term problems of getting employment back into work, and that was so important for winning the city onto the side of the library and getting them to understand what the library was going to be about. Just a few little pictures. This is again part of what we did at the points of construction. Now, I don't know what it's like in Thailand, but in the UK, very strict standards of health and safety about getting small children onto building sites, which can be dangerous places. But we did it. And the constructor didn't like it at first. After a while, they came to think this was a fantastic way to get their name well known in the community for doing good things that engage with children and education, and indeed the wider community. This slide shows its age rather horribly now, but again, this was, you have to remember, this is now maybe 6 years ago. Actually, we're a little bit off to the left of what we wanted to achieve. So we actually built the library in Second Life. How many people are familiar with Second Life? Ooh, not many. It's a virtual environment, which was 6-7 years ago, it was going to be the next big new technology, and it's just gone nowhere. We spent a certain amount of money building the library in Second Life, which was led by a team of younger members of staff. I certainly wouldn't have known how to do it. It was great that we let them do it. It did help the design process, and it did help engagement. We could visualize for people what the library would look like. And we used games in Facebook and apps, again, allowing younger members of staff who got more skills with the technology than most, certainly of the senior management team, had at that point, and actually taking risks. And if they didn't work, that needed to be okay. It had to be, the phrase is, you should ask forgiveness rather than permission. So not everybody feel that they needed to come and get the sanction of the senior management team every time they hadn't had a good new idea. So just a few images, I'll rattle through quite quickly now. This is the great and the good of the city of Birmingham, so business leaders, political leaders. This is the night before the library opened, so the pre-launch party. And again, it's a great public space, which they liked. We've done some other interesting things in that space, which I'll show you in a minute. But it really was important to us that, as well as encouraging traditional library users to keep coming back, encouraging new communities, the people who really needed us, the people who have got economic or social problems, but also it was important to us to get the business leaders of the community into the library, using it for different reasons. Maybe they're coming to a dinner or a cocktail party or for a business meeting, but they actually are finding new ways to engage with the library. They will talk about it. They think it's important. And of course, whenever you design and lead a new project, and I've been doing this for it's about 15 years before the library opened, you do worry about what will happen on the first day. Will people actually like it? And this was the queue to get into the library on the first day. And I knew at that point that we'd got a success. And people never stopped queuing to get in for the first week, which was tremendous. Much about civic pride. It was important to us to have real credibility amongst our population, because the community of Birmingham, encouraging that civic pride in a facility that was really theirs was so important. And so these figures of how they rated the library, whether they would revisit the library, 95% positive, or whether they would tell other people they should come and use the library, 94%. All of that was really important to us, because it enabled us to argue with the politicians and those who have control of the purse strings. Okay. I want to turn now briefly to just a brief exploration of the role of staff in the new library. Three things. We knew we would have no more staff than we had in our old library. We were predicting twice as many visitors. In fact, we had three times as many visitors. So we had to find a way for our model of organising staff to deal with three times as many visitors with the same number of staff. So that immediately tells you, you can't carry on doing it the same way that you always have been doing. Secondly, we wanted to break out of a position that maybe unusually, I don't know, you tell me, but we'd found ourselves in where we had librarians doing the wrong jobs in the library. So librarians trying to be event managers, exhibition managers, marketers, facilities manager, and it didn't work. So we said we need to have the right people with the right skills doing the right jobs. And thirdly, and I did touch on this earlier on, recognising that actually we needed to make sure that the right people in professional terms were doing the right jobs. So when we analysed the inquiries that were coming into the library and were being dealt with by professionally qualified librarians and archivists, 95% of them could have been dealt with by somebody with about 2 weeks' training. So we were paying people really to do jobs that were a bit boring for them, and we were paying more than we needed to. So we did very much change the balance of staff. So the number of librarians, and I'm sorry if this is a challenging message, but the number of librarians that we employed in the new library was much less than before, because we employed different specialists to run IT, to run events and so on, and we employed people with the right level of skills and qualifications to deal with library inquiries. So almost a form of triage system, so the library assistants would deal with the first point of inquiry and hand it on to somebody better qualified if that was the appropriate route to take. And the list of this is a completely unedited list. We challenged staff. We had a workshop with staff and said, look, these are the reasons why the sort of traditional roles that you've been taking on are not going to be the same. So what are you going to be? How will you describe yourself in the future? And these are just some of the things that they came up with. I'm certainly not going to go through them all. But they were, it makes interesting reading, I think. I take a lot of heart from this slide, and the one that is the most significant statistic for me is this one here. So people who are coming to borrow books or films or music or any other items, it's 15% of the total number of visits. Now, I don't think that children are going to stop borrowing and reading books anytime soon, but I do think that the number of books borrowed by adults is declining fast and will continue to decline. But this gives me a lot of heart that actually we can find other reasons for people to come and use the library, because there's a huge range. And although the percentage numbers here are not very high, this is 25,000 people in a year. It's quite a significant number. And along with that, I mean, and I'm very proud of the fact that in the first year of the library being opened, almost 3 million people came to visit. But actually, I'm rather more proud of the little story I told you a few minutes ago about the homeless man. That I don't know how many visits he's worth. 100,000? 500,000? I don't know. But the quality of the experience and the way in which the library can change people's lives is surely more important than the numbers. So we moved fairly quickly to an environment in the library which focused on events. And these were many and various and had a number of things I'll say about them. The first is that we wanted to make the library an event-rich environment. So to illustrate that, in the first year, we had 2,500 events happened in the library. So that's, I can't do the maths, it's about 7 or 8 every day. And those might be a concert. So here we have a black gentleman who's actually singing opera, Italian opera, dressed as a Russian Cossack. I don't know why. And it doesn't really matter why, because lots of people came because they were interested. The events were also part of this, certainly part of the philosophy of the library, that you learn from experiencing things, surprising things happening in different environments. And critically for me, and I'm going to say a bit more about this as well in a moment, this word co-production, where the library was not the only organisation responsible for events. So, there's questions to ask when you run events about risk and control. So one of the things here, one of the more interesting and challenging visits was on the second day we opened, was the visit of the Reverend Jesse Jackson, the American politician. He was fun to deal with. It's Americans, I think. But this was our brochure for the opening season, and we actually handed over control of that brochure to a group of young people in the city who called themselves Birmingham 2022. And we said, you design it, we'll take the risk. And that was a brave decision. I don't know whether it was a good decision or not. The outcome was mixed in terms of its quality, but I think the process was absolutely the right one, that we are letting other people into the operation of the library. So what happens in the library now? Some of the things that the library does on its own, some of the things that we do with partners, some things that we allow other people to do, and some things that actually just happen, and we have no control and no moderation over them. We might stop them if they get out of control, but things like being a bit bold with rock music, for example, in the library, during opening hours, so not necessarily when we're closed. This sort of junk modelling that I mentioned, this is actually This is more purposeful than it looks, because this is a device called a lantern slide projector for showing old photographic images. And we're doing a workshop there with a group of children and older people. So the ambience that you create in the library is critical to... Have I gone back one? Yes. What sort of rules do you want to apply? How do you want the space to work? How do you want staff to respond when you get issues? So here we have... we had 2,000 children in the library, and they were rehearsing for a concert, and they sang all day the same song. That was quite challenging, but actually it was an incredibly positive experience for them and for other users of the library. We had a few complaints, but mostly very good. This is another rock performance that we had in the library. So whose library is it? Are you prepared to take those risks and let people do what they feel should happen in a library? I'm going to move on from that. I'm saying the same messages, really. It's about risk and opportunity. The programming of events that we took was, again, to make sure that we were as inclusive as possible, that we were providing not just a cultural experience for traditional library users, but that we were actually providing events that would attract a young audience, a black audience into the library, audiences who would be engaged and hopefully encouraged to come back. We were never quite as good as we should be at using those first-time visits as marketing opportunities, and that's maybe something to think about. So this again, this word pride was one that came up so often, and we wanted to encourage that sense of civic pride, whether that came through business leaders having a gala dinner, whether it comes through young people curating their own photographic exhibition. Again, we didn't moderate that. We let them have the space. They designed the exhibition. They do all the work associated with it. They ran the launch event. So giving over spaces to other people to use. And creating opportunities. And I said earlier on, an important word for me was surprise. And making things happen in the library that you didn't necessarily know a library would do. And always asking the question, well, don't put it like this. Don't ask the question, why should we do that? Ask the question, why should we not do that? And so we run singles nights, we run graduation opportunities, photographic opportunities, and weddings as well. The library is a venue for weddings. You can do salsa, you can do zumba. We put on one musical show. I didn't think it was very good, but never mind. So things that are surprising should happen in the library. And we learned a lot about events programme, about the building, and about how we needed to build in consistency and make sure that we had a continuous cycle of successful events taking place. We had a lot of exhibitions in the library. For the first time, we had an exhibition gallery to show off some of the amazing collections that the library's got. Some of those exhibitions happened outside, as with this one. I can't explain this. But we learned an awful lot about how to run an exhibition and how those should be curated. Here we worked with a lot of organisations interested in their own history in the city. It's true, because it is inevitably true, that the collections of the archives in our library and our local studies department reflect the white middle class record of the city. And what we were trying to do here was to work with communities from the African Caribbean communities, the Asian communities in the city, Chinese, Polish, Sikh communities, whatever, to encourage them to come and use the library. So to run workshops to explore the resources that we have that are relevant to their communities and interests. We use volunteers. I don't know whether volunteers are used in libraries in Thailand very much. We use them a little bit, mostly for working in library gardens, which was interesting. But it's something that I think it's a big debating point for libraries in the UK at the moment, whether or not we should be using volunteers to help run our libraries. If anybody wants to ask questions about that, we can do. Just a little bit of a case study. One of the huge, to illustrate that change that I was talking about from transactions to transformation. So we used to run a business information service, which pretty much did what it said. It provided information for businesses. And as the World Wide Web has gained more and more traction, the bottom has really fallen out of that market. And we could have killed that service. What we decided to do was to refocus it away from established businesses and onto that agenda that I was talking about earlier about employability and economic success. So it is now a service that focuses on what we would call pre-startup business. I hope that makes sense. So people who would like to run their own business, people who want to be entrepreneurs. And we will take them through the skills that they need to develop, the knowledge that they need to have to set up their own business, to run it successfully, the knowledge that they need to have of, say, tax affairs or copyright, intellectual property, employment law, if they're thinking of employing some other people. And we will run workshops, digital skills, but we'll run workshops. Library staff will do these. And we will also work with partners, which helps people get into work, gives them the basic skills, understand how to write an application form for a job, how to do a good interview for a job. And we work with firms of lawyers and firms of financial experts. So the important thing for library staff is that they are empowered to deliver workshops, but they also know when they reach the limits of their knowledge and they need to bring in an expert to help with the next stage of advice. And a lot of that came from the work originally that we did with the music business. So our music library, as well as doing traditional functions of a music library, actually we started to get into issues of music copyright, and then we started to help people establish their own, if they'd got a band, how they were going to get an agent, and how they were going to get recording contracts, and all of that snowballed from that very successfully. We actually, one of the bands that we encouraged had a number one hit in Indonesia, which was one of our claims to fame. Always need to ask yourself the important question, is change for everyone? Now, we had an organisation of around 170 people. It doesn't really matter whether you have 5 or 500 or 5,000 people. There will be challenges because not everybody in your organisation will understand or be supportive of the need for change. I was one of those people who put my hand up earlier when I was asked, do I like change? Because I do, but you need to recognise that a lot of people do not. And we broke it down, and you can argue about the different percentages here. But we reckoned about 20% of the staff who were completely on board of the changes and the transformation of journey that we were taking. About 20% who were opposed, and maybe about 60% who were, we'll wait and see what happens. And the big mistake that we made was that we spent too much time actually working with this group to try and convince them that, if you like, we were right and we needed to change their minds. Waste of time. They were never going to change their minds, and most of them have left the organisation now. We need to work with these people and convert them to being part of the majority. And so, well, last words really. Some of the successes that the library enjoyed in its heyday, certainly endorsement from the royal family was great to have. See, it doesn't want to go away. Yes, but there he is again. Point to him, yes. he's actually giving, I don't know whether the gestures are the same, but in the UK, the thumbs up gesture is a positive gesture of support. Is that the same here? I'm not being rude. So he's actually, what he's actually doing is he's giving a thumbs up sign to a reporter who's asking him whether he thinks that Aston Villa, which is our local soccer team, will win their match this afternoon. And he's saying yes. But it actually looks as though he's giving the thumbs up sign to the library. So we'll keep that one. And then this is a black Birmingham-born actor. And this guy you may have heard of is Jeff Lynn from the Electric Light Orchestra. I don't know, musical cultures are very different. But so we were getting endorsement from all leaders in all walks of life. In a way, this is the picture that makes me think this is what success looks like, rather than endorsement from big names and getting my photograph with somebody famous. This for me, and the pleasure that the children are getting from the library, that defines success. That's my email address down the bottom. The sun is setting. This is our old library, which is now being knocked down. And the new library here. I used this slide initially because I thought it was quite symbolic that the sun was setting on the old library. In the last year or so, since I left the new library, it's suffered an awful lot of budget challenges. So nearly 100 members of staff have left the library, lost their jobs, but it remains a great, much visited place and much valued, much loved in the community. And I do think the sun will... We have a saying that I think probably applies all over the world. If the sun sets, it's probable that tomorrow morning it will rise again. And I think it will rise again on the new library. Thank you very much for listening. Appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Brian Gambo.
Thank you so much, Mr. Brian Gambo.
Stand in the middle.
Okay, นะครับก็เป็นช่วงบ่ายนะครับต้องขอบคุณคุณแบรนด์มากที่พาเราตะลุยอีก1ชั่วโมงที่ผ่านมานะครับหลายท่านคงได้เห็นแล้วห้องสมุดในเบอร์มิงแฮมที่คุณไบรอันดูแลอยู่ไม่ใช่แค่ยืมคืนไม่ใช่มีหนังสือแต่เป็นศูนย์รวมทุกอย่างเป็นสัญลักษณ์ของเมืองนะครับทุกวันนี้ถ้าคิดง่ายๆก็คือว่ามากรุงเทพแวะ TK Park หน่อยแล้วกัน
ใช่แล้วค่ะ
เราใจดีไว้ก่อนเขาได้จัดบ่อยๆนะฮะทางที่ดีก็แบ่งงบไปพัฒนาห้องสมุดมหาลัยและโรงเรียนมัธยมด้วยดีไหมครับ
ดีเลยค่ะ
ปรบมือดังๆได้ครับผมโอเกรฟคิดภาพว่าตะกี้เราคุยกันข้างหลังว่าคิดภาพนะฮะถ้าเกิดห้องสมุดในโรงเรียนมัธยมในต่างจังหวัดเนี่ยโอ้โหได้แบบเบอร์มิงแฮมไปนะฮะมีโรงละครมีร้านกาแฟเป็นศูนย์กลางของเมืองนี่น่าตื่นเต้นมาก
เรียกได้ว่าคนเนี่ยไม่ต้องย้ายเข้ามาอยู่ในกรุงเทพกันเลยทีเดียวถือว่าได้อยู่บ้านเกิดของตัวเองแล้วก็มีความสุขสนุกสนานกับคนในครอบครัวด้วยค่ะ
ครับผมในช่วงนี้นะครับจะมีคำถามสักนิดหนึ่งไหมครับให้คุณไบรอันแกมเบิลนะครับน่าสนใจมากท่านไหนมีบอกได้เลยนะครับมีล่ามดูแลตลอดครับผมชูมือเลยฮะเดี๋ยวไมค์จะเดินไปหาท่านนะฮะ
Okay, if you have a question, you can raise your hands or maybe send a piece of paper to our staff and we will answer your questions. มีคำถามไหมคะมีคำถาม
อ๋อข้างหน้าเลยนะครับอ๋อคำถามมาจากคนใกล้ชิด
ค่ะคุณเหี่ยนั่นเองนะคะ
เป็นสิงคโปร์บุกลอนดอน
มาแล้วค่ะ
คุณเหี่ยน please
thank you very much for a very interestingpresentation. I was looking at the picture now that you have frozen it on the screen. Is this inspired by some culture? Because it looks rather Middle East to me, the image. So I wonder whether, you know, when you were planning this library, were there some thoughts on what you wanted the exterior to look like? Thank you.
ค่ะ สำหรับคำถามนะคะ ประมาณว่าการที่สร้างอันนี้นะคะได้แรงบันดาลใจมาจากอะไรแล้วก็มีการเขาเรียกว่าวัฒนธรรมอะไรอย่างเงี้ยค่ะได้มาเป็นยังไงทำไมถึงได้ออกมาเป็นรูปแบบแบบนี้ค่ะโอเคค่ะ
The picture it's a really good question because the answer is the picture was taken by a member of the public and posted on social media and in the early days I was employing a photographer to take a photographic record of the building. But I actually stopped that because members of the public were taking millions of pictures of the building and posting them on social media, much more powerful than a release from the library. So that image was just one morning, there it was on Twitter. And so I've stolen it. If the question's about the exterior of the library and the rings, it's not culturally significant, and it's decorative, but I think what we were concerned to avoid was, and this is where you don't want to take risks and make mistakes, it's the circle is in nearly every culture in the world is a positive image. I'm not actually aware of any cultures where the circle is a negative image. So we wanted to convey that it's open for business for everybody.
โอเคค่ะก็สำหรับรูปภาพอันนี้นะคะก็คือว่ามีช่างถ่ายภาพนะคะหลายๆท่านถ่ายภาพออกมาแล้วก็คุณไรอันนะคะก็ได้นำภาพนี้มานะคะจากรูปของโฟโตกราฟเฟอร์หรือว่าท่านถ่ายภาพนักถ่ายภาพท่านหนึ่งนะคะก็คือก็แค่ว่าเห็นว่าภาพนี้สวยดีอะไรเงี้ยค่ะแล้วก็สำหรับการออกแบบนะคะก็คือได้มีการออกแบบที่มีเหมือนเป็นวงแหวนเป็นริงวงกลมนะคะก็คือซึ่งถือว่าอันนี้เหมือนเป็นสัญลักษณ์ของสิ่งที่ดี positive อะไรเงี้ยค่ะเหมือนกับความเป็นการรวมกันเป็นสิ่งหนึ่งสิ่งเดียวกันค่ะ
โอเคนะครับเดี๋ยวเราคุณไบรอันยังอยู่กับเรานะครับเดี๋ยวช่วงสุดท้ายคุณแบรนด์ก็อยู่เราถามได้อีกนะครับช่วงนี้ปรบมือดังๆขอบคุณคุณไบรอันแกมเบิลคร
ับ Thank you so much Mr. Brian
ขอบคุณครับโอ้